Today on the Perception in Action podcast, what is metastability? How can we develop adaptable athletes by training in metastability regions? So it's time for a call to action. Hi, everyone. This is Rob Gray from Arizona State University and PerceptionAction.com. Welcome to the Perception in Action podcast, where I discuss how psychological research can be applied to improving performance, accelerating skill acquisition, and designing technologies. In today's episode, I want to look at the concept of metastability and how we can potentially harness it to develop adaptable performers. But before that, I want to mention a few new things I've added to the podcast website that you might be interested in. First, I've now completed 20 of the Perception in Action journal clubs. While I've worked most of these into podcast episodes, there are a few that were too visual to be appropriate. But you can find them all by going to my YouTube channel, link in the show notes or on the front page of perceptionaction.com. Second, I've created some new resource pages for the CLA in differential learning, which you can find at perceptionaction.com. These include infographics, some explanations of key points and terminology, links to relevant podcast episodes, journal articles, books, etc. Related to this, I've also set up a new support tier in Patreon, so that those that might be interested can work directly with me via monthly video calls. This could be for coaches interested in input on practice design, practitioners wanting some ideas or help with analyzing performance or tracking data, companies developing new sports training technologies, or anyone that's looking for research-related assistance. If you're interested in working with me, which would also help to support the podcast, please check out patreon.com/perceptionaction. Okay, on to the topic of metastability. The concepts of stability, multistability, and metastability were discussed in the context of coordination in an article by Scott Kelso published in 2012. To illustrate them, I want to use the example of catching a ball with your hand, as in cricket or with a glove in baseball. A common way that especially a new learner might solve the problem of coordination in this situation is by keeping their hand always pointed fingers to the sky, then moving their arm up or down to catch balls at different heights. Thus, if we plotted the orientation of the hand in degrees on a graph, going from 0, fingers pointing downwards, through 180 degrees, fingers upwards, back to 360 degrees, fingers downwards, there would be an attractor somewhere around 180. Remember, an attractor is a region in the state space, in this case the possible orientations of the hand, which the system is drawn to. So for example, if a fielder started with their hands on their hips, the hand would quickly move towards the 180-degree attractor once the ball was hit. Attractors develop both via learning and practice, and there are also intrinsic attractors, ones that are due to our individual constraints. The stability of an attractor refers to how quickly the system returns to that point in state space, which in my example would be very quickly. For example, if you always caught a ball with your fingers pointing up, when you stumbled and your hand angle changed, you would immediately get it back to the 180-degree angle. The situation I've just described is what is called monostability. That is having one highly stable attractor. A useful way to conceptualize attractors is as a landscape. So in this case, if we move through 0 to 360 degrees, we would have flat ground until we reach 180, where there would be a huge valley representing the single attractor. Stability is reflected in the depth of the valley. If a valley is really deep, the attractor is very stable, it takes a lot of effort to get out of it. In most cases, monostability will not be an optimal coordination solution because it doesn't allow for flexibility or degeneracy. And this is the case in my ball-catching example. If you always try to catch with your fingers up, it's going to be very difficult to catch balls hit very low to the ground. And you often see this with kids in learning to catch. They will try to keep their hand up and will not be able to get it low enough to get under the ball. A much more effective coordination solution in this situation would be, of course, to use two different hand orientations depending on the height the ball is hit, with fingers switching to pointing downwards for low hits. Having two stable attractors, in this case, one at 180 degrees and one at 0 degrees, is the simplest form of multistability, called bistability. In the attractor landscape, we would now have two valleys, with the ball height being the control parameter which causes a shift from one to the other. So, a system that is multistable is one which has two or more coexisting attractors, and for which fluctuations in the system, for example changes in control parameters, allows for switching between these stable states. Why do we have multi-stability? Well, it goes hand in hand with degeneracy or functional equivalence. That is the fact that in movement, the same outcome can be produced by multiple different muscle configurations. Having multiple stable states allows us to harness the redundancy to be adaptable, using different movement solutions for different constraints we are facing. To quote Kelso, multi-stability confers a tremendous selective advantage to the brain and to the nervous system in general. It means that the brain has multiple patterns at its disposal and can switch among them to meet environmental or internal demands. End quote. Or as Mark Latash would say, it's the bliss of motor abundance. But it's not all sunshine and lollipops here. Multi-stability does come at a cost. Due to the stability of the attractors, it can be sometimes difficult to switch from one to the other. Using my catching example again, you sometimes see this with less skilled athletes. They attempt to catch a relatively low ball with their fingers still up, stubbornly holding onto that pattern of coordination. Another way of stating this issue is that it's difficult to be both stable and flexible at the same time. These are competing tendencies. Multi-stability can also create a very unstable region between the attractors in which fluctuations in the system will cause multiple shifts between states. Think of a new learner shifting their hand up, then down, then back up again, seemingly unable to decide what to do. A final issue associated with both mono and multi-stability is one that I've talked about on the podcast a few times now. The challenge of trying to destabilize the attractors in the system if you want the learner to develop a new pattern of coordination. Say, for example, you wanted to teach a new learner to catch a ball passing to the side by rotating their hand to 90 degrees. If they were bistable with attractors at 0 and 180, this would be difficult because it would be hard for them to hold this new orientation. This is, of course, where methods like the CLA and differential learning, which attempt to destabilize existing coordination solutions, can come in. The process by which the attractor landscape is changed with learning depends on the individual. If it requires a complete restructuring of the landscape, for example, as in my catching example, adding a new third attractor at 90 degrees, this is called a bifurcation. While if it requires just small changes in the location of the attractors in state space, we call this a shift. As the description suggests, a bifurcation will be more difficult and take longer than a shift. This is one of the reasons why individual performers self-organize at different rates, some seeming to do it relatively easy, while others struggling to find an effective solution. It's going to depend on the attractor landscapes they're starting with or their intrinsic dynamics. These individual differences in attractor landscapes are part of the reason why some athletes self-organize better than others, which is an issue I'm going to tackle in my next episode. So in sum, having multiple stable states of coordination can be advantageous in that it takes advantage of degeneracy, but at the same time, it can also be somewhat limited in its flexibility and may be difficult to shift between or change the attractors. As Kelso says in his article, bring on metastability. To use his definition, quote, in coordination dynamics, metastability is not just a word. It is the simultaneous realization of two competing tendencies, the tendency of the individual components to couple together and the tendency for the components to express their independent behavior. Although reminiscent of a multi-stable regime with attractors, a key difference with metastability is that transitions are not actively induced. No disengagement mechanism is required. Neither stochastic noise nor energy inputs from the form of parameter changes are needed in order to switch from one state to the other. Metastability allows even the lowest of nervous systems to flexibly browse through a set of possibilities, thereby avoiding getting stuck in stationary states. End quote. So multi-stability and metastability are similar in that they both involve having more than one coordination solution. The difference comes in how we move between these solutions. In multi-stability, there are very stable attractors at the solution, and a change in the constraints is needed to get the system out of one of the attractor states. Think of an attractor landscape with two or more very deep valleys. Metastability is the ability that some skilled performers seem to have of essentially coexisting solutions that are weakly stable and allow for the different solutions to emerge more easily. Think of valleys in the attractor landscape that are not as deep, so they're easier to get in and out of. Again, in Kelso's words, in a metastable region, there's attractiveness, certain areas in the state space are more appealing to the system, but not attractors, where the system is pulled in and it can be difficult to get out of. Being metastable has potentially huge advantages for sports because it essentially allows for flexible degeneracy. To quote a 2012 article by Pinder and colleagues, metastability is a property which helps neurobiological systems to remain in a state of relative coordination with performance environments, poised between multiple coexisting states of movement organization, ideal for performance in dynamic sports, end quote. Going back to my catching example, metastability is being able to keep both the fingers up and fingers down solutions in a state of weak stability, so that they can emerge at any time depending on the task constraints, rather than being dependent on control parameters or fluctuations in the system. To understand this a bit more, let's look at a couple studies that have investigated this concept in sports. In a paper published in 2006, Herstovsky and colleagues examined the stability of different movement solutions in boxing. Specifically, what parameters determine when a boxer uses a jab versus a hook versus an uppercut punch? 8 participants who had just completed a 12-month basic boxing course were asked to hit a heavy bag. The main task constraint that was manipulated was the distance of the boxer from the bag. Importantly, this distance was measured in a body-scaled manner. So instead of being expressed in meters or feet, it was measured in terms of the arm length of each boxer. So a distance of 1.5 Well, difference in terms of the actual physical difference would be the same in body scaled units for all boxers. It's 1.5 arm lengths away. This is, of course, critical for the perception of affordances. Whether a target affords hittability depends both on the information from the environment, the actual distance, and your action capability, how far you can reach. The frequency of the 3 different types of punches was measured at different body scaled distances in the study. What was found? At a relatively far distance of about 1 to 1.2 arm lengths, boxers threw almost exclusively jabs. So in terms of what I've been discussing, there was monostability. At relatively short distances of 0.3 arm lengths, there was bistability, in that boxers threw either uppercuts or hooks with roughly equal probability. Finally, for an intermediate distance range of about 0.45 to 0.65 arm lengths, boxers use a varied mixture of uppercuts, hooks, and jabs. The authors argued that in this region, boxers exhibited metastability because the choice of punch was not driven by any particular control parameter. Instead, boxers seemed to be able to flexibly switch between the different movement solutions. These findings suggest that even after a relatively modest amount of training, in this case 12 months of boxing practice, there are regions of metastability in which performers can exploit movement degeneracy in flexibly switching between movement solutions to satisfy task constraints. It also again emphasizes the critical importance of adding variability or noise to practice conditions. It was the variation in distance that led to the emergence of these different movement solutions. A similar finding was reported by Pinder and colleagues in a 2012 study looking at cricket batting. Based on the boxing findings, the authors hypothesized that there would be a metastable region depending on the distance of the pitch. For those that don't know, in cricket, bowlers can vary the length of the pitch. So some are short and the batter has to move forward to hit it, while others are long and the batter has to move backwards. In this study, 6 moderately skilled junior cricket players were asked to hit pitches thrown at different distances. Distances were again body scaled, in this case by the batter's height. What was found? Again, there seemed to be regions of stability and metastability. For short pitches, batters always move forwards, while for long ones, they always move back. But within an intermediate region, there was a flexible mix of shots played. Interestingly, within the metastable distance region, there was also higher variability in terms of initiation times and backswing and downswing durations. This suggests that the batters were utilizing functional variability in their swing to adapt to the task constraints. So what does all this mean for coaching? Well, clearly it seems that even moderately skilled performers can develop metastability for certain regions of the task parameters like distance. And while performance wasn't directly assessed in these studies, it's hard to imagine that having such adaptability and being able to flexibly and easily switch between different movement solutions wouldn't be advantageous. It is also likely to make a performer co-adaptable, in that they will be better able to adjust to their opponent's actions. For example, countering when an opponent tries to close down the distance in boxing. I think a key for future research is understanding how these metastability regions develop. How does a performer go from very stable solutions that are hard to switch between and may be used in inappropriate conditions to this state of flexible metastability? But it seems obvious to me that there would be clear benefits of identifying this region for the sport you're working in and focusing a part of training within this metastable range. So for example, given that we know experienced boxers have a metastable range at a distance of about 0.45 to 0.65 arm lengths, I think it could be beneficial to focus training sessions for novices at this specific range. Training in an identified metastable range is another way that we can push a performer's system into a state of instability, which we know helps to encourage exploration of new solutions. And if when we put them in this range, they're still showing mono or multi-stability, such that they're overly stable in their solution, this is where a constraint or a differential learning type perturbation could be added to try to support the development of metastability. As Pinder et al. Conclude, quote, placing learners in metastable performance regions creates adaptable flexibility and functional variability in their timing and performance responses. This type of variability can provide the basis for co-adaptive moves by a learner in sport, amplifying the exploratory nature of the learning process and can aid the discovery of functional and individualized solutions for a specific task goal. End quote. Okay, that's it for today's episode. Remember, you can contact me at robgray@asu.edu or follow me on Twitter at shakyweights. To find out more about the podcast, please check out perceptionaction.com. Finally, to support the podcast and receive bonus materials, including written transcripts, please head over to patreon.com/perceptionaction. This is Rob Gray from ASU. Cheers for now, and keep them coupled.